I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. Welcome to my legislative report. We've been working on legislation that would tend to set the standard for wellness in the state of New York so we could have some type of agreement on what type of preventive steps people ought to do, what type of screening people ought to do, what type of lifestyles people ought to do. One of the people we've been working with has been Dr. Jennifer Lindstrom, who's double certified in boards in internal medicine, pediatrics, and also works with on clinical nutrition problems for individuals. And she, through the American College of Surgeons, has been talking with us. We're trying to come up with a draft of some legislation. But the basic thing is everybody knows good health, but we don't have really a set of protocols to follow good health. And I actually wanted to go a little bit deeper on that today. I was trying to say, what could we do to tell folks about steps they should take for good health? And then I thought, well, wait a minute, let's divide the segment down. Let's deal with just women. Women are supposed to be the ones who are the caregivers. They take care of themselves. But then I've often saw in the literature that they take care of themselves because of reproductive medicine. Mm-hmm. They're very good, and they tend to think, well, I've seen the doctor, I don't need to do anything else. But the rising numbers of women with heart disease, the rising number of women with diabetes, show that they have other concerns outside of gynecology. So I thought, let me hit you up. You're really a triple threat here. Mm-hmm. And maybe you could say, you know, what would be the steps a woman should be taking in regard to being proactive about her health and the medical profession?
Yep. So it's very important that women do have their regular GYN care. Cancer screening is very important. But it's not just reproductive cancers like breast cancer and cervical cancer that women need to be concerned about. Other cancer screenings, maybe colonoscopies or even skin cancer screenings. But getting back to heart disease being the number one killer of women in the United States, there's other numbers that count. So what is your blood pressure? What is your cholesterol? Are you physically active? So physical activity is important to maintain general health. A lot of times we lump it into, I'm trying to lose weight, I want to exercise, but regardless of what your weight is, it's important to be physically active to maintain good cardiovascular health. Women typically see their GYN doctor once a year. Now, if you have a slightly elevated blood pressure or an abnormal cholesterol, those things probably warrant follow-up more than once a year, and that's where your general practitioner or your primary care doctor can really play a key role.
Now, I don't know this, but when you go to the GYN, do you get your blood tests done and all of that so there's a range of the chemistry that's looked at so that if your cholesterol is out of whack or there's something else, salts or whatever, somebody's going to be on the alert?
Yeah, so how GYN doctors practice is different. There are some GYN doctors who they routinely do your blood pressure when you come in for the office visit. They take your height and your weight so they can assess you for your body mass index to see if you're in the healthy, overweight, or obese range. Some GYN doctors will order cholesterol panels or blood sugar panels to look for diabetes or prediabetes, but it's not standard, I would say. So if they find an issue like that, GYN doctors sometimes will refer you back to your primary care doctor, assuming, of course, that you have one. And we know that access to primary care doctors is becoming a bigger issue here in the United States.
Well, let's just talk about that. Somebody living in the suburbs, should they be having a primary care doctor? They haven't had anything particularly bad. They've had they've got their flu shot, but they haven't had anything bad. Should they be taking steps to preventive steps?
Absolutely. Everybody should be taking preventive steps. I mean, that's the whole point, is not to develop disease. We're not really good at that right now in the United States. We do a lot of sick care. But you know, you're not going to know what your blood pressure is. You can't feel your blood pressure. So you need to have that measured. It's important to get guidance from a medical professional in primary care about what steps you can take additionally. Like I said, exercise is really important. It's hard to find time, but there's small things people can do to build exercise into their day. So taking steps, taking stairs, or longer periods of exercise during the week, like if people play on a soccer team or something like that, that's great. You don't have to exercise every day, but you want to get in enough exercise on a weekly basis to improve your cardiovascular risk.
Years ago, people used to say, get a checkup once a year. Mm-hmm. But that's kind of fallen by the wayside. We don't necessarily need a checkup, but you need to have a regular physician. And people don't tend to do that.
Yeah. How often you need to see the physician depends on your particular medical problems. Some medical problems, like diabetes, for instance, people need to be seen at least twice a year, if not every 3 months, depending on how well controlled they are with their diabetes. There's blood work that needs to be assessed, urine tests, they need eye exams. So it depends on your medical problem as to how frequently you need to see a regular physician. In terms of regular yearly physicals, if you're completely healthy, you have no high blood pressure, cholesterol problems, you're active, you're at a healthy body weight range, then the recommendations are you don't necessarily need to go every year, but maybe every other year is sufficient. But, you know, if a doctor is giving you a prescription, you probably need to see them once a year. You know, your needs may change for your prescriptions, even if it's for something as simple as allergies.
My contention would be some point you need a baseline.
Yes, correct.
Some point you need to know
absolutely
what your bloods are to see if you have an inclination to diabetes or anything like that, or if you develop it. I have a friend whose son, who's been totally active, totally healthy, almost a vegetarian, all out of nowhere gets a diagnosis of diabetes.
Yep.
But was there a baseline for them to evaluate? And that's the difficulty I think people have of, well, I'd like to see the doctor. Why? What's wrong? Nothing.
Right.
And you go, well, what would you like to do? I'd like to establish a relationship with you to be my primary care physician so that, you know, I have some type of interaction.
Yep, but also to assess other behaviors. Are you smoking? Clearly a humongous risk factor. How much alcohol are you drinking? Again, sleeping habits. There's other things that go into a healthy lifestyle that may or may not be assessed at, say, a GYN visit, getting back to women's health. So I think it's important to have an overall checkup with a physician and to just make sure that you are being proactive and you know what steps to take. Sometimes it's not totally clear where you need to go, and it depends on your family history. You know, some people have a genetic history that puts them at high risk for diabetes and heart disease, and those are people you might monitor more frequently.
But sometimes we don't even know the genetic history.
Correct. Absolutely.
Our folks passed away, and we didn't follow it up. We weren't, 50 years ago, might not have been as good at diagnosing things as now.
Absolutely.
And in fact, now let me just put it to you this way. You, with the experience you have in internal medicine and all, if you're a mom and then you have a daughter, what do you start to tell her besides the reproductive health medicine? How do you, what type of guidance would you give her in terms of you're now 5 years past your well baby visits, that wonderful set of protocols we have for young children? We don't have to invent it for young children. That's all done. But we don't have well baby visits for teenagers, for the 20s and 30s. What would you start to advise us? How do you approach health?
So for teenagers in particular, it depends on whether or not they're actually active in sports. There are recommendations that if a child is playing sports, that they get a sports physical every year. That's to assess cardiovascular risk, also make sure they haven't had a lot of injuries. Concussions, there's a lot of literature out there for teenagers with particular sports, even soccer. Cheerleading for girls, okay, so it's not just football and wrestling and things like that for the boys. But, you know, children do need regular checkups with their physician because they're still growing. So, you know, your height and weight is pertinent to your health, and there are guidelines for overweight, healthy weight, and obesity in children. So those are really assessed at the physician's office as well. Once you're beyond your high school years and you're in college, I mean, you enter college, you usually need a physical. Depending, again, if you're playing sports, you may need more frequent physicals. But, you know, there's, again, you know, it gets back to what you're doing for mom. You know, what is your blood pressure? We do diagnose high blood pressure problems in even children who are in sixth and seventh grade. So, you know, it is important to have those things monitored, even high cholesterol problems. You don't know until you check, and the person who can do that for you would be a primary care provider.
Now, a lot of times, you see a physician, a pediatrician has to see an individual till they're 18, and then there's a handoff. I've never was totally sure of exactly what the protocol is.
So there's pediatricians and internal medicine doctors are both trained in what we call adolescent medicine, which is typically the guideline is somebody over the age of about 13 or so. So typically before the age of 13, the care would be provided by a family practice doctor or a pediatric doctor. Between 13 and adulthood, it could be either one of those or an internal medicine doctor. So internal medicine doctors are trained in adolescent medicine as well. I think it probably depends on what's available in your particular community. There's, you know, on the West Coast, there's a lot of family practice doctors. There tend to be more pediatricians and internists on the East Coast. And of course, we know there's big differences between what's available in a rural setting versus what's available in a city type setting.
But how do you do the handoff? Or is it try to go to like the practice associated with a particular hospital you're located near? We got three or four hospitals that are right down in the spine of my district, New Island and NUMC yeah. and Winthrop and MedMercy. So I guess you try to pick somebody associated with the hospital so the pediatrician can say, oh, I know a couple of internists or something like that.
Absolutely, and we do get referrals. My practice is unique. We are both an internal medicine practice as well as a pediatric practice, so we can follow children from birth through grandparenthood, I guess, if you want to say. But we do get referrals actually from other pediatricians who say, you know, this person is now 19 years old. We don't want to provide the care anymore. Will you take them on as a patient?
Now, once they get to be 19, you do a baseline with the internal medicine clinician, and then how often after that?
Well, again, it depends on their personal risk factor. So, you know, remember, obesity is a chronic disease, and unfortunately, two-thirds of the adult population in the United States is either overweight or obese. Being a chronic disease, it's kind of like high blood pressure. You don't see, if you have high blood pressure, you see your doctor more than once a year, and hopefully with obesity management, what we can get to is really trying to provide more regular care for people to help them with the problem, because it's a lifelong problem, and it has a lot of comorbidity associated with it, like heart disease, diabetes, lung diseases as well, things like asthma, sleep apnea, so there's a lot of medical concern when it comes to overweight and obesity, which unfortunately is very common.
And then again, I would go do the baseline, get a baseline. And of course, you mentioned this earlier, BMI, body mass index.
Correct, yep.
What does that all signify?
So body mass index is a screen. It's a way of assessing, are you in the healthy weight range, overweight, or obese? And I say it's a screen because all it does is it gives you a number to put you into a category. And what it's trying to assess is, do you have excess body fat? Now, let's take Michael Phelps, for instance. So Michael Phelps, I think people can appreciate he's very fit. He has very low body fat, but by BMI criteria, he's actually in the overweight range. But clearly, BMI is not a good tool for him. He's an elite athlete. BMI is good for the average American. Okay, so it's not good for elite Olympic athletes. It also probably actually underestimates risk in people who are severely obese, more than 200 pounds overweight. So it's not perfect, but we have additional assessments we can do to see, does your BMI fit where you are? So what is your waist circumference? In men, you want it to be under 40 inches. In women, you want it to be under 35. Abdominal adiposity is an indicator of cardiovascular risk and diabetes risk. So that's another important indicator. You can also measure your body fat. There's scales you can buy at home that can do that. There's tests that doctors can send you for, although insurance typically doesn't pay for it. But there's additional assessments that could certainly be done. But if you've been identified as having a BMI that puts you at risk for medical problems, it's important to be assessed for those.
And the BMI, you can get a lot more information just by Googling BMI, and it all pops up.
Yep.
We've also started a couple of years ago to have children's BMI measured at school.
Correct.
We did it, I think, on a blind basis because some people didn't want their children to be labeled as obese.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it's an immense tool. And I remember reading a study 2 years ago that said if you are in the average for BMI, mm-hmm. your life expectancy is a lot longer than if you're an outlier.
Yeah.
So that's an important thing just in terms of taking care of yourself and using this as a measurement, as a ruler of your own health.
Correct. Yes, absolutely.
Now, what would you, just the last part is, if you haven't seen a doctor, and you're now 45, what would you have people do at this point? They've had good health up to now. They don't know that looming is the age of 50 when they start to use the healthcare system a lot more. What do you start to do at 45?
Absolutely take a family medical history if you know it. Some people are adopted or don't necessarily know their family history. What is your personal risk? So what is your blood pressure? What is your pulse? What is your height and weight and your BMI? Somebody who's 45 and hasn't seen a doctor in a while is definitely going to need assessment of their full cholesterol panel, assessment for blood sugars. These are guidelines from the government. And, you know, prostate cancer screening for men, it depends on what ethnicity you are.
We're out of time, Dr. Lindstrom. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Thank you. I'm Senator Hannon. See you again next time.